This is the podcast for Narrate Church. Narrate Church meets every Sunday at 9 and 11 a.m. at the Grand Street Theater in Helena, Montana. For more information, visit www.narratechurch.org.
Do you remember what it felt like when they broke up with you? We're going to kind of jump right out of it, right into it this morning. I remember there was that 6 weeks, there were those 6 months, there were those couple years, and you thought this was the one. I mean, granted, you were 9 years old, but come on, I mean, you were hopeful. Seriously, though, do you remember? Do you remember what rejection feels like? Or maybe even worse, do you remember what it felt like when they asked for the divorce? When they told you that they were in love with another? When you found out they were with another? Do you remember what it felt like when you had to sign those papers, when you had to go to those court proceedings? Or do you remember what it was like what it felt like when he hit you? Didn't see that one coming. Didn't sign up for that. And it wasn't just a physical pain, was it? It goes a lot deeper than that. This morning I want to explore just some realities. And I think first it requires that we just acknowledge that rejection is horrible. And it's not limited to romantic relationships, is it? Do you remember what it was like when you found out that they were talking about you behind your back? I mean, it wasn't that you were surprised that there were people who didn't like you. I have a friend who says at any given point, 10% of your population's mad at you. Be warm and well-fit. If you're a leader somewhere, it's probably more like 30 or 40. It wasn't that there was someone that didn't like you. It wasn't even that they didn't think that you were perfect. It was the reality that you trusted them. You confided in them. If you ever thought there was somebody who would bring it to your face, you would have swore it would have been them. And if you've ever been on the receiving end of gossip, there's something horrible about that. Ever been robbed or had your house broken into and later found out that it was somebody you knew? Why does that hurt so bad, and why does it hurt more than for reasons beyond financial ones? I remember at one point in my student ministry tenure, there's that weekend every October where there's a four-day weekend, and we took a bunch of students on a retreat, and while we were gone, our house was robbed. And I just, you know, it was kind of the reality of the situation was someone did that because they knew what I do for a living, and I work with students, and they took advantage of that. And the hurt of that goes way beyond a mountain bike or anything like that, doesn't it? Remember what it felt like when you didn't get the job? And it was like this friend, this person you knew that you really thought you were going to get the job, not just because they were a friend, like you thought you were qualified and you gave it your all, but they said no. Or do you remember what it was like when you got cut from the team? Or do you remember what it felt like when, as a child, you honestly reached out to your parent, but they weren't around? I mean, maybe literally, maybe physically, but as an adult today, you recognize there was this desire in you to have more relationship, and they couldn't, because they lived in another state, or they didn't live in the house, or worse yet, they did live in the house, and they were so busy or so emotionally removed, they just didn't know how, or they didn't have time. That maybe you're an adult and you have adult children now, and I mean, you've worked, there's nothing in life that has demanded more energy from you, and you've been written off. Gotta imagine, I'm not there, but I can't imagine anything hurting much more than that. Or maybe you're an adult and you're beyond the teen phase, you know, like when you turn 16, your parents are idiots, and then when you're 21, they're geniuses, and when you got back to the genius side of things, you started to reach out to them relationally, and they don't have time for you. Or maybe you had your first child and you remember what it was like to grow up with grandparents, and you've really tried to bring your parents or your dad or your mom into a relationship like that with your kids, and they just don't want it. There's something personal about that, isn't there? Like divorce, breaking up, adultery, spousal abuse, betrayal by a friend, even things like not making the team or not getting the job, getting let go. They have, there's something about them that reminds us that love is risky, doesn't it? That if you're going to choose to have relationships, if you're going to choose to make yourself relationally available to others, whether that's as a friend or that's as a professional or that's in a romantic relationship, it's a reminder that there's risk involved, that it might be hurtful. We've titled this weekend, Naked Isn't Optional. Getting naked, I think, is the way we titled it, isn't optional. And if you're visiting, you're going, what kind of church is this? Well, we're in a series, as you might have concluded from that. It's a sexuality series, but only kind of. So far, what we've explored is this idea of angels and animals, and what we talked about was that we're prone to these extremes when it comes to sexuality, and that what's really common is to treat sexuality as a biological act, as a biological act with no consequences whatsoever, completely detached from the rest of life, just like eating food or going to the bathroom. And what we explored is that both Moses and Paul, these huge contributors to the Bible, these men who knew God extraordinarily well, what they both say is, wait a minute, you're more than the sum total of your physical urges. You have a spirit. And so we explored this idea that what Paul is telling us is you were made for more than just fulfilling your physical, biological desires, that your life has a higher purpose than that. And yet at the other extreme is this idea of angels. And to be real honest and self-critical, it's people like me and organizations like this that are most guilty of the angel view, because what they say is that sexuality is dirty and it shouldn't be talked about. It's embarrassing and it should be left off. I had a friend tell me this week that in his tradition, it was just a known fact. You don't talk about the bedroom at church. And what we began to explore is that maybe that is unhealthy. Because yes, we are beings, we are physical beings with biological urges, with a spirit, but we have a body. We are not just a spirit. An angel just has a spirit. A human being has a body, and God created us, say the scriptures, say Paul, say Moses, say Jesus. And thus, when you open the text, you see men and women who understand that sexuality is a gift from God. We're not angels, we're not animals. And then last week, we explored this idea of lust. We titled it, Is Bigger Better? You can tell that we're going for drama in our titles. But we didn't even really talk about sex. If you were here, you know that what we explored is this idea that lust is about way more than sex. That lust makes promises that it often doesn't deliver upon, and if we don't get that under wraps in our life, it's not just going to destroy us sexually, it's going to destroy us in all kinds of different ways. Why does betrayal hurt? Why is it so profoundly difficult? Why is it that vulnerability opens us up so dramatically? And what do we do with that? In the Bible, there's several different guys and gals who address this issue. One of my favorites, and it's been pointed out to me, is in the Song of Solomon, or the Song of Songs, or the Song of Solomon, depending upon your tradition. But there's this thing that goes on in this book, and it's really a book of poetry. It's really a book that's quite erotic I don't know if that's the right word, but it really is. In fact, so much so that some Christ followers get embarrassed about the implications of the text, and they create these kind of hyper-spiritual interpretations that say that it's not really about sexuality at all. It's about you and Jesus, which, well, may be the case, but Jesus hadn't been born yet, so that's kind of a problem. But in 2:8, there's this conversation that happens, and just to kind of bring you up to speed, the woman, she refers to her lover as my beloved. And she says this, look, my beloved, look, here he comes, leaping across the mountains, bounding over the hills. So there's this gal, and she sees her lover coming towards her place of residence, and she says, my beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag. My wife often calls me a young stag. I'll just come home from work and she'll go, look it, there's the gazelle. Ladies, if you're married, my assignment for you this week is to refer to your husband as a young stag or a gazelle at least once a day for the week. And it would be best if you could do that in front of his coworkers. There's my young stag. Look, there he stands behind our wall, gazing through the windows, peering through the lattice. Now, in this culture, of course, what we're talking about here are people who would have been married in their teens. In fact, many scholars, I subscribe to the idea that Jesus' mom was 12 or 13 years old. So you're dealing here with a very young woman, and that explains the wall, because she's still living with her parents. She still lives under her parents' roof. She still benefits from the predictability and the provision that comes from her parents. Her brothers still beat up the other kids on the playground when they bug her. Like, her world is safe, it's controlled, it's protected. And see, in this, well, we won't go there yet, but so what he's saying to her, sorry, that was distracting, but what he says is this, he says, my beloved spoke, So now he's talking. My beloved spoke and said to me, arise, my darling, my beautiful one, come with me. See, the winter is past, the rains are over and gone. Flowers appear on the earth, the season of singing has come. The cooing of doves is heard in our land. The fig tree forms its early fruit, the blossoming vines spread their fragrance. You got to give the guy credit, right? But he's persistent, and what he's saying is like, open your eyes to the possibilities of you and I. He's referencing spring. He's saying, look at the flowers, look at the plants, look at life is springing forth. In Israel, winter is not associated with snow, it's associated with rain. And so he's saying it's over, like this could be us. There's so much possibility, so much potential. And if you're a dad with a daughter, you're probably going, man, I've heard guys do this and it's annoying, just so persistent. But you got to give the guy credit, right? Like, guys, how many of you could say the cooing of doves with a straight face? Go ahead, try that as a pickup line this week. The cooing, I can hear the cooing of doves. Let me know how that works for you. But do you see what's going on for her? Like, do you see the risk? Like, he's asking her to leave what's safe and comfortable and predictable and to walk into the unknown. What gives a dad anxiety about marrying off his daughter is the same thing that's giving her anxiety in this case, is there's all this unknown. What if it doesn't work out? What if he's not who he's presented himself to be? What if her parents aren't in favor of her marrying him, and then she goes and it doesn't work out, and she spends the rest of her life hearing, I told you so. What if he hits her? What if he goes off to war and he never returns? See, there's risk. She could get her heart broken. And that risk doesn't go away with marriage either, at least in her story. In chapter 5, the story continues, but at this point, they are married. And the text says this, I slept, this is her speaking again, I slept but my heart was awake. Listen, my beloved is knocking. He says to her, open to me, my sister, my darling, my dove. This guy's got issues with birds. My flawless one, my head is drenched with dew, my hair with the dampness of night. Now, scholars debate about what exactly is going on here, but one likely possibility is that he's been gone. He's been at war, he's been traveling, he's just been out of town, but for whatever reason, he's returned at an unexpected time in the middle of the night, and he's saying to her, come on, let me in the house. And she says, I have taken off my robe, must I put it on again? I have washed my feet, must I soil them again? Incidentally, you could translate this from the Hebrew to English, I have a headache. It's another possibility to how you could do that. Actually, I was talking to a friend this week about this series, and he was just kind of like, I can't believe it is bigger, better, like really, Adam, like you really can't say that. And he said, but here's what I do. And he said this as though he does this, though I am not recommending it, I'm only offering it for comedic relief. But he said, every once in a while, I would go up to my wife at dinner, and I will offer her 2 Advil. And she will say, what are those? And I will say, they're Advil. And she'll say, what are they for? And I'll say, they're for your headache. And she'll say, I don't have a headache. And he'll go, yes. I say, if she calls you a gazelle, you can do that. You see what she's saying though, right? Like, anytime but now. Anytime but now. I mean, this is inconvenient right now. And then she catches herself, the way we catch ourselves when we say things to people that we love that we don't mean, the way we reject people and regret rejecting them. She catches herself and she says, my beloved thrust his hand through the latch opening. My heart began to pound for him. I rose to open for my beloved and my hands dripped with myrrh, my fingers with flowing myrrh on the handles of the bolt. I opened for my beloved, but my beloved had left. He was gone. My heart sank at his departure. I looked for him, but did not find him. I called him, but he did not answer. It's a reminder that the vulnerability doesn't go away with marriage. He came towards her and she left him standing. He gave her options and she took the one that he would prefer her not to take. It's a reminder that love can be painful. And it's something that several different authors in the scriptures capture. It's something that our media captures. It's something that Hollywood captures. But you know what I think captures it better than anything else? Country music. Like this guy's song called Like My Dog. Go ahead.
that he's sick of this house. He never says, why don't you get off that couch? It don't cost me nothing when he wants to go out. I want you to love me like my dog. He never says, I need a new attitude. My sister ain't always in a feud. When I leave the seat up, you don't think that it's rude. I want you to love me like my dog does, baby. When I come home, want you to just go crazy. He never loves me like he might hate me. I want you to love me like my dog.
Got another one. Yeah. There's a classic. The poets speak about the vulnerability of love.
Say you were wrong to ever leave me alone. And now you're sorry, you're lonesome and scared. And you say you'd be happy if you could just come back home. Well, here's a quarter, call someone who cares.
We got one more. I'm told it's a classic. Clint Black. Stop that. That's terrible. I realize some of you listen to that music. I don't know why. Now I've offended Patriot fans and country music fans, so we'll just meet at my house next week. Question is, why is heartbreak so universal? And the question that I would pose in response is, what if it's because it's as old as God? Literally. Because in Genesis, what Moses tells us, what the ancient people, Hebrew people, believed about God is that God made them to have relationship with him. But one of the things they noted and they were quite passionate about was he made them, but he gave them the option to choose to love them or not to love them. God's story is your story. God, too, had to make a decision to be vulnerable. And what the early Hebrew account records is that people consistently said no. No thanks. I appreciate the gesture. Thanks for the text message. Thanks for the invitation. Thanks for the promise. But I'm going to say no. And in Genesis 6, a pretty catalytic verse in the text, in 6:6, it says this: the Lord regretted that he'd made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled. A God with a heart. A God with a heart that could hurt like your heart can hurt. A God with a heart that hopes and yearns and desires and experiences pain. A God grieving is what Genesis 6 gives us. And why is he grieving? Because he extended himself to people and they said no. See, for some of you, this might be a completely new understanding of God. A completely new way of viewing and thinking about God. Maybe you were brought up to see of him as a taskmaster, as some kind of divine judge, as a critic, as someone who made a list and checks it twice, as someone who has subscribed or given you some list of arbitrary abstract rules, as someone who wrote an instruction manual. The Hebrews, they saw him as a lover, as one who desired relationship, extended himself relationally, and experienced pain, regret, rejection. And I think it gets to this question of, so what or who is behind the universe? Is it some abstract list of truths? Is it something like fate or luck or karma or something along those lines? Or is it, as the scriptures say, a God who loves, who who takes relational risks, who extends himself and experiences regret. One of the ways that you can read the Bible, if you go about reading it from left to right, is a God who opens things up with this option. And in the early stages, even in the book of Exodus, you see God revealing himself to the people in his power and his might. Now, we know that he wanted people to know that he loved them. And in the early pages, some scholars would suggest that what you see in him is giving expression to his love by his power. One way that you can see this in the text is in the Ten Commandments. We looked at them last week. We will look again just for a moment. In Exodus 20, there's something that I haven't made this observation. The rabbis made this observation centuries ago. But what I want you to watch for is this. Watch how from the second command to the third command, the voice changes. Watch how it moves from God speaking personally to the people to God removing himself and someone speaking to the people in his place. It says this, and God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. Very personal. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. Very personal. Now let's look at verse 7. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. There's a shift. For the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. This bugged the rabbis because this is what they did is they studied scripture and they wondered, why did his tone change? Why did his voice change? And what they said was because the people couldn't handle it. The people couldn't handle God coming forcefully. The people couldn't understand God to be loving when it comes in all of its power and all of its might and all of its authority. Which raises this question, if you were God, which is a pretty dumb question to ask, but if you were God, and you wanted people to know how much you loved them, how would you communicate that? That's where Jesus comes into the biblical narrative. That's the role Jesus plays, because what the Bible says is God sent his son, and now he's going to communicate his love not through his power and his might, but through his unmerited persistence. That Jesus would be an expression of love, not through this, like, look at me, look at the thunder, look at the clouds, look at all these things that I can do, but his love would be expressed through his servanthood, through his selflessness. Like, just think of the story again, that Jesus, there's this baby who's God and man. He's born to teenage parents in questionable circumstances. Remember, a lot of people through the course of Jesus' life didn't believe that Mary was a virgin. They made fun of her and him for that. So he was born in these questionable circumstances to these parents who were poor. We know we were among the poorest because when they went to offer their offering at the temple, they offered the least that they could possibly offer and still look themselves in the religious mirror, so to speak. He was born among the animals, among the dung and the straw. The first place he was laid to rest, or the first place he rested, not that he died, but you know what I mean, outside of his parents' arms, was in a feeding trough. And then fast forward his life, his own siblings thought he was out of his mind. When he went to his hometown to give his first sermon, the crowd thought he was crazy. They formed a mob and tried to kill him. He was eventually surrounded by friends, but when he was arrested, they all abandoned him. Like, this is God not using power, not using might, but something else entirely. He finally goes to trial, he goes to the cross, and there he hangs, naked, thirsty, bloody, alone, completely alone. So why have Christians for centuries, why have they held so tightly to the cross and its importance? Is it because it's through the cross that God says, I know what it's like. I know your pain. I know your vulnerability. I know how much it hurts. I know how it hurts in ways nothing else can hurt. Like, is the cross, is it God relating to your story? See, if you've ever extended yourself relationally to somebody and had them say no, like you know Jesus' story. If you've ever extended yourself to somebody and had them leaving you there, hanging in the balance, waiting, Jesus knows your story. The cross is Jesus' way of saying, I know what it's like. I know what it's like to invest everything in yourself into a relationship and have that bring you nothing but pain. But one of Jesus' best friends who did abandon him but did come back is a guy named John. And towards the end of his life, he's reflecting upon his experience with Jesus. He's reflecting upon Jesus and his character and all that was amazing about him. And he says this, he kind of boils it down to this really concise statement. He says, this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. See, you just put that verse out there on a poster, on a billboard, or on a sign, and it doesn't mean as much. But when you consider it in the context of the rejection you've experienced, when you remember how bad it hurts and how hard it is to be persistent when it's not working, it takes on a new meaning. This is love. That Jesus said, here's my move, and now I'll wait for yours. Jesus is an expression of God saying, I made them and they get to choose. But when they reject me, I'm not going to get insecure. I'm not going to recoil. I'm not going to pout. I'm just going to keep pursuing. I'm going to keep loving. I'm going to keep making myself vulnerable. John, in another place, John, if you're not familiar with the Bible, 1 John is often for people who kind of try to condense a book. 1 John is known as the love book because that's what he's really talking about. And if you are familiar with his writing or if you're not, he's particularly passionate about this issue of love. And in his gospel, which is the larger book, and it's in his gospel that he's really taken a swing at Jesus' life and the importance of it, he says this. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, him being Jesus, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own didn't receive him. And he goes on to say, yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in him, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. See, for John, Jesus' persistence, it stands out. When you choose to love someone, you give them power. You give them the power to say yes or no. You give them the power to decide. And that leaves you vulnerable. It leaves you wide open to being hurt. And yet, is nakedness optional? Ever talk to somebody who's in a marriage where one member of the marriage is just chose to become hard? It doesn't work. Maybe you're that person. Maybe you've been there. Ever talk to somebody who had a job and they just chose to close off towards their boss or their employees or their coworkers? It doesn't work. See, Jesus' story when it comes to vulnerability is one that says, hey, vulnerability is not an option. If love is the goal, vulnerability is a mandate. There's one story that I think captures this so remarkably well in Jesus' life. It's kind of messed with me all the way back to youth ministry days. There's this story where Jesus, one of his closest friends, in fact, Jesus was surrounded by these mobs of people, and as he was surrounded by mobs, he would have to pick who would get to spend the most time with him, and this guy made the cut of that circle of guys who would get to spend the most, guys and gals, that would get to spend the majority of their time with him. And in fact, even within that inner circle, if you will, when he had to begin to analyze, like, who can I trust? Like, who is intelligent? Who's got business savvy? Who's good at accounting and budgeting? He chose this guy. This guy's name was Judas. And Judas, ultimately, he betrayed Jesus. And Jesus, what's fascinating to me is Jesus knew he was going to betray him. At his Last Supper, you know, you've seen the painting? At the Last Supper, the guys ask him, like, who's going to betray you? And he tells them in this kind of subtle way, he tells a couple of them, like, it's going to be Judas. And yet the next line wasn't, so Judas, get out of here. Go have dinner somewhere else. He just kept on. And then on the night before, or the night Jesus was betrayed, I personally don't think he knew he was going to be betrayed because he, like, knew the future. I think he kind of opted out of that power, but he understood what was going on. I just want to read you this account. While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs sent from the chief priests and the elders and the people. So not only was Judas going to betray him, he was going to unite with his literal mortal enemies. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them, the one I kiss is the man, arrest him. Imagine how offensive that is. I'm not just going to betray you, I'm going to betray you with this gross, fake act of affection. Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Now, what's interesting to me are Jesus' next words, because they're not, you bastard. They're not, how dare you. They're not parenthetically, and then Jesus punched him. His next words are this: friend, do what you came for. Friend, do what you came for. I don't know how this lands for you. I can tell you how it lands for me. On the one hand, I hope it moves God's love out of the abstract and into the personal. Because you know what it feels like to be rejected. You can appreciate how hard it is to be persistent. Can't you? Like, as an employee, as a boss, as a friend, as someone in a relationship, as a married person, you know how hard it is to keep being the activator when the other person is taking advantage of you, when the other person is rejecting you. Now, parenthetically, can I also say, I realize that there's a place where it's invaluable and important and healthy for a relationship to end. So please don't hear me saying otherwise. There's a place for that. That's a separate conversation. It's a conversation we've had in the past. It's a conversation we'll have again. Please don't hear that message. But I hope that what this does is it lifts the God is love statement off of the paper for you and helps you know it. Because everything that you find to be difficult in a relationship, for every reason why you find loving your enemy to be hard, that's what God has done with you. On the other hand, if you're not a Christ follower, we're thrilled that you're here and want you to continue to be here, but you're kind of off the hook on this one, because I don't think this one applies to you. But for those of you that do follow Jesus, I think the challenge here is, like, do you love like Jesus loves? Because loving people when it's safe, that's the easy part. Loving people when there's no risk that you're going to get hurt, that's the easy part. I guess my challenge to us is, if you could just identify one person in your life that God is going, no, I want you to love them with a different kind of love. I know they tell you that they don't need you. I know they reject you. I know they're hurting you. I know that they make you feel insecure. I know that they don't appreciate you. I guess I'm hoping there's one person that you can identify that you can love in spite of all that. And yes, of course, for their sake, because as much as we say, if you were God and you wanted people to know that you love them, what would you do? He sent Jesus. Well, the question in the 21st century gets answered a little bit differently. What the writers of the New Testament tell us is the answer is, well, I'll send my church. That's why we scatter, because we think there's only so much telling of God's love that we can do in the confines of this room. So there's the advantage of, like, you're getting to tell God's story by loving that person that way. I also think there's the advantage of having a better appreciation for the way God feels about you. Because as much as you hate and resent and resist pursuing that person, like, you've done the same thing to God, and he's pushed through it all, every bit of it. If you're a married person, I hope this morning it's a pretty indirect path to this conversation, but I hope it challenges you. If you know that you've closed off, that you've become hard, that you're going through the motions, I hope it begins to challenge you and raises the question of, is love even possible inside of that? And there might be some really good reasons why you've allowed yourself to become hard, and that doesn't mean you don't have to process those somewhere. But if this is a relationship series, I think we would be remiss if we didn't make the observation that if there's no vulnerability, there's no love. And as it comes to sexuality, well, I think this is where it gets a little messy. Because we have to ask ourselves the question, if there's not relational vulnerability, but there is sex, what do we have? A business arrangement? What the ancients called prostitution? And that's not a shaming statement. It's a, you were made for way more. And God made your sexuality for way more than that.
For more information on Narrate Church, visit www.narratechurch.org or download the mobile app, now available for iPhone and Android.